And joining us in the joining us for a hot coffee this morning, we have with us House Ways and Means Committee Chairperson Joey Salceda. Congressman Salceda, good morning to you.
Yeah, good morning, Karen.
All right, before I ask you about the proposed wealth tax of the DOF and the possible luxury tax, I wanted to ask you of the president's statement in Davos, Switzerland, when he told the president of the World Economic Forum that he really entered politics as a matter of political survival for his family. What are your thoughts on that?
Kasi if you read through it, kami mga politiko, once the mic is in front of us, of course, we have to think of what to answer. But if you read through what he has been doing for the past 7 months, I think it has been redeeming for his family. Redeeming in the sense of the good policies, of the good kind of economic strategy in the Philippine Development Plan. So I would say that the process of redemption is there.
The process of redemption is there for you. What do you make of comments that, number one, he's been 7 months in office. This is his 8th trip. While yes, Davos is very high profile, we all know that. There are bigger problems here in the country. You have inflation. I mean, you have the price of onions, rising price of eggs, salt, so many other issues that actually, yun ang kumbaga malapit sa bituka at wala dito ang Pangulo.
Kaya nga may cabinet. Pangalawa, titingnan din natin kung may strategy to deal with these specific problems. Pero tatlong taong kasi parang walang ano, it is like a vacuum in international marketing of investments in the global market. So I think perfect nga na the Philippines would be first out there after 3 years of virtually very little international marketing, especially yung Davos. There was no Davos for the past 3 years. So I think tama lang po. Wag lang araw-araw. Pero I think it's a very well-picked naman yung events like the ASEAN, the APEC, and of course the Davos. So it was a way of projecting. And he has to sell himself as a Marcos, remember that. Because the Marcos that the world knew was a very different one, his father. But I think the son, I think he's presenting himself to be a better version of the father.
When you say wag araw-araw, what do you mean by that? Not to travel as much, right? So what's the barometer for you?
Depende kung saan siya pupunta. Kung pupunta naman siya sa isang napakaliit na wala ka namang, there's no national benefit or national interest involved. So definitely, that would be a frivolous trip abroad. But I think if you look at the 8 that he went to, those are very critical foreign visits for the president.
And what's your reaction to President Marcos Jr. describing the 6 years after his father as the dark times for the country? He was clearly referring to after People Power won, that's after the revolution, and the 6 years of Cory Aquino.
Ayun ang problema natin, no? We need to disaggregate the first statement, which is dark days for his family. And the second part, which is the dark days for the country, I think there's a tendency for politicians to usually, you know, once they make these pronouncements, to add more dagdagan mo pa ng paminta nung asin. So basically, generally, if you go through the way he was saying it, so parang it was a natural how would you call that, a natural qualifier, just to sabi niya hindi lang naman kami ang naghirap, pati yung country. But of course that is debatable, and it has been quite debated by well-debated by Etta Rosales.
Oo. And do you agree with that? That 86 to 92 were dark days for the country?
Titingnan natin yan from so many parameters. Siyempre, we now have a constitution which he respects. So I think in that way, and he was elected through that same constitution. So I would say that he himself is benefiting, not from those dark days that he was talking about.
All right. Now let's move on forward to the proposed wealth tax of the Department of Finance. I know you prefer another form of tax, a luxury tax, but the proposal of the DOF starts with a tax on the 1% of wealth above 1 billion pesos, 2% on wealth above 2 billion pesos, 3% over 3 billion pesos. And the finance department believes that this alone would generate a whopping 236 billion pesos a year from the 50 richest Filipinos alone. It sounds good, but why aren't you for it? Why don't you agree?
Hindi ko pa nakikita yan. Hindi ko pa nababasa yan. I don't know. I haven't read it actually. It hasn't been formally proposed to the Committee on House of Ways and Means. Okay. But I'm sure baka iba po yung author niyan. It may be Oxfam. So it may not be the DOF because the DOF and I are always, you know, layo kami nag-uusap, and I think we are on the same page always in most issues before we come out in the public. Kasi pag tinax mo yung wealth, tatakbo yan eh. So anong 200 billion? 200 billion somewhere in the Cayman Islands? So I think it's a very mobile, may cryptocurrency. We have a bank secrecy law, one of the strictest in the world. So how can you find that 200 billion?
Okay, so let's talk about what they say are the pros and cons of a wealth tax. So what you believe is one of the negatives is tatakbo lang yun. A general wealth tax, right?
Well, halimbawa, isang mayaman. Di ba pag yung pinakamayaman ngayon si Arnold, no? Yung may-ari ng Louis Vuitton, yeah. At saka John.
Yeah.
Pinaglalabanan niya ng mga countries na doon na lang siya maging citizen. Like Spain immediately offers citizenship to rich people. Portugal, I can name you a lot of countries who want rich people to be their citizen. So It runs contrary because they want rich people to be on their neighborhood and therefore they're more likely to spend their wealth there, buy villas there, you know. In other words, and probably invest there too by sheer familiarity with their surroundings. Mm-hmm. So, yun po ang number one na pangalawang rason. It's contrary even to the investor's visa. We're trying to offer investor's visa. If you invest in the Philippines, how much? I think $200,000, you get a long-term visa. So because you are investing here, so it's contrary to those
Okay, now just for the record for our viewers, I was reading off House Bill 10253, so possibly this is not what's discussed now. This was then supported based on the DOF website. Supported then by former Secretary Carlos Dominguez. But moving forward. Okay. So you don't agree to a wealth tax. You'd rather that we have a luxury goods tax. Tama ito.
Yeah, you have to catch the rat. So you can catch the rat because they eat, you put a cheese on the mouse catcher. So I'd rather catch them when they're eating the cheese.
So define luxury for you. How would we define luxury then? Let's talk about that. This would be interesting.
Well, I don't know. You want a Merriam-Webster dictionary definition?
Go ahead. Yes, Congressman.
Well, para sa akin, tinignan na lang namin kung anong mga ginagamit ng top 1% ng population. Luxury watches na above 50,000, luxury cars, private jets, sale of residential properties above 100 million, yung mga wine, above 20,000, do you know that this country is drinking 10.3 billion pesos a year on wines, whose per bottle is 20,000, leather products above 50,000, and we're spending 11.3 billion of that. So, I mean, we are in the process of going one by one, and this is the initial list. Actually, this is not yet the final. This is not the final list.
Okay, so let's start with something relatable, which is alcohol, for instance. You mentioned wine. Won't that be covered already by sin taxes? Because correct, would you agree that there are already excise taxes, right, for distilled spirits?
Yeah, there's a separate scene in the moral code called conspicuous consumption.
Okay.
Abang yung kapitbahay mo ay hindi makabili ng tubig, ikaw umiinom ka ng wine above 20,000. Other one is a sin tax because you're trying to kill yourself by drinking something that's not good for your health. So those are two separate sins.
Okay. All right. Now let's talk about, for example, the definition of luxury. In an interview, you said a luxury, if it's beyond reasonable reach for the vast majority of the population and is not necessary for any essential function. It's actually a good definition. Right? Okay. The problem then is the vast majority of the population are under what is right now, based on your studies, the earning of the vast population. Because I know there's a big gap between the 1% and the rest of the Filipino people.
Well, of course, we have to start somewhere. Mm-hmm. So this is, to me, is a good start. Unlit-lit nga ang kikitain at 20%. Una-una, meron na kasi tayo sa Republic, sa NIRC, National Section 150. Kaso tatula ang nakalista, jewelry, perfume, and yacht. So maraming hindi nakalista dun sa, at saka pag binabasa ko yung lahat ng report ng BIR, wala dun section kung magkano, wala silang linya dun na nakalagay kung magkano ang nasingil nila doon.
Interesting to, Congressman, because how then, this is interesting. Let's talk about, tama kayo, nakalagay doon, jewelry, perfume, and yacht. Na interesting nga because yung perfume, hindi mo naman makonsider na super luxury, di ba? Kasi hindi naman ganun kamahal ang range ng perfumes na maraming ibinebenta. But tama kayo, so let's talk about cars. Because you already heard, I believe it was George Barcelona comment earlier that they'll just find, you know, parang magkakaproblema sa smuggling, di ba? Yung pagpasok ng kotse. So let's talk about cars. Won't that already be double taxation? Because when you already buy a car, regardless of what brand it is, you are already taxed. There's already... you already have a value-added tax to it, or you have already a sales tax to it. Won't that be double taxation? Ano yung tax na ipapatong pa doon?
Basically, it's a luxury tax, non-essential goods tax. Mm. The one is really an excise tax on cars. And generally, a 5 million luxury car is, it's definitely out of the ordinary reach of, 99% of the Filipinos. So, surprisingly, no, we are buying more Louis Vuitton than luxury cars.
Okay, so we'll move to the Louis Vuitton later on. But I'm curious with cars. Tama ba ito that 4 million and above, the train tax rate goes up by 50%? So then, malaki na ang tax rate for cars above that particular market?
Ay, dati nga, triple dapat eh, di ba?
Okay. So naniniwala, kung magpapataw kayo, Congressman, how much would you add? How much percent of the price 20. Of the vehicle?
20 across the board.
20 across the board.
I am a believer of simplicity and a flat rate. So if it's 20, 25, 30.
So let's say, are we talking about if a Land Cruiser, the newest one today, is 5 million pesos, you're telling us 20% of 5 yes. million. All
so
right.
That's about 2.3 yeah. billion in new revenues.
So yun yun, so it would be 20% of the retail price, so to speak, yes. of the luxury okay. item. So okay. maganda yung punto nyo, tama kayo, Louis Vuitton's bags, because we're seeing right now so many consumers coming out of malls having so many Louis Vuitton bags or buying them, you know, etc. And it's good for the market, right? You have people spending. But how would you tax? Let me know nga. Sige, tell me. How would you tax? If you go into the Louis Vuitton store, you're already, let's say a bag is 300,000. You already have VAT on that, right? How many taxes are already imposed on the sale of that?
12% VAT lang.
12% VAT.
Pero yan ay sinisigil sa customs. Kasi zero duty siya.
Okay.
Huli siya sa customs.
Yes, but when you buy from the store itself.
Di ipapass on na yun nung store. Mm-hmm. But definitely this will be collected at the customs.
Okay. So kung 12% lang yon, what are you seeing, Congressman, na ipataw pa doon?
20%, though that's 2.26 billion.
Wow, so then a Louis Vuitton bag technically will have 32% tax.
Opo. That's you have to pay for your conspicuous tendencies.
Okay. All right. Now, I'm curious, but then what about people that would buy it abroad? I mean, will this help the stores here, businesses locally? Because then they might be selling. Well, I'm not justifying for luxury goods because I don't buy myself. But wouldn't this affect the economy? Wouldn't this affect local businesses?
Ay, hindi. Kasi baka nung pagpunta ng Hong Kong, sarado pa ba Hong Kong? Pagpunta ng ng Jeju.
Na, siguro you have 10,000, 15,000 pesos tickets.
So, ang 20% ng 10,000 din. At saka, hindi ka pwede, the conspicuousness of it that you are buying it here in front of so many other poor people, you derive, how would you call that? Some immoral pleasure from being seen as buying something so expensive in front of others who cannot.
Okay. Now, you're speaking clearly from a moral point of view, which is important. But logically speaking, a wealth tax, for example, it's practiced in several countries. You have France, Spain, Norway, Switzerland.
Yes.
They impose this, but not in the United States. But do you have model countries that impose a luxury goods tax?
In our sense, because of the reports or because of the huge disparity in income, that is the fundamental basis, wherein you have the top 9 families having more income than the rest of the 55%.
Okay. Don't you just support the wealth tax for these top families?
Kasi na, impractically, hindi mo naman yun mahuhuli.
Would that be so? But then they would have to declare their assets.
Well,
how then you tax them, because a wealth tax isn't an income tax. I'm just curious, right?
Well,
it's
I can
easy to determine the assets of the top 1%.
Una, it's not very accessible. I can easily come up with, forget cryptocurrency.
Okay.
Which is very difficult to find in the first place. And number two, I can come up with layers and layers of corporate ownership, which essentially the beneficial owner will always be very difficult to tax.
But then why is it then done in other countries in Europe? Because the wealth tax will at least unburden the middle class. I mean, I do understand the negatives, but a luxury goods tax also burdens the middle class, because you do have middle class buyers. Logically speaking, in consumption, you will have middle class buyers who have saved for that Louis Vuitton bag for whatever reason, right? Who will buy a 100,000 peso watch for whatever reason. Why burden them with the 1% that's extremely wealthy?
Well, the state is telling them, "Oy, ibayad mo na lang yan ng ano? Ibayad mo na lang yan ng tuition dun sa Ateneo. Igilan mo na nga yung pagbibili ng Louis Vuitton na yan."
But
that then, is the message of the state. Point,
that's the message, but then essentially, it affects the middle class. That's my question.
Hindi na siya middle class. Ibig sabihin middle class ka, pinag-ipong ka, pinangutang mo. That in itself is already conspicuous. Well, we're not punishing them for being any of these things. We're punishing them because they're buying something that is to us is a conspicuous consumption.
So for you, Congressman, it's just that it's more difficult to tax the extreme wealthy.
Impossible.
That's the only reason you're supporting the luxury goods tax. It's just because the very wealthy can get away with it. But is that good enough a reason?
Kaysa zero. In the first place, the non-essential goods tax is a very good start. And it points us to the right direction of taxing the rich. And if you study the Philippine political economy since 1946, our most grievous and virtually mortal sin is our inability to tax the rich. And therefore, our tax to GDP is still the lowest in the ASEAN.
Mm-mm. What are our other ASEAN neighbors doing, Congressman, that you feel the Philippines is not doing in terms of taxation and tax collection?
Maganda ang kanilang tax call, may tax moral sila talaga. So hindi mo na kailangan habulin para magbayad sila. Pangalawa, I think the greater difference is not in the tax rates because we're actually on the high side. It's really on tax collection efficiency. We just have more smugglers, more tax evaders.
Okay, all right. Now, can we move on to something else since you brought up the issue of smuggling? The price of onions. I mean, I know you're the chairperson for the Committee on Ways and Means, not agri in the lower house, but it already seems to defy logic. The price of onions in this country. So based on the hearings in the lower house, based on the Senate, there's already been criticism that the timing for the importation is wrong. But can you explain, Congressman, why the prices are this high?
Asa lang, cartel. Tamang cartel na yan, hindi mataga rito. Mga pito ata yan eh. Pero ayoko na maanin dahil wala mako, of course, we're doing our own research. Kasi yung Senate, isa o dalawang senador lang nakakapagpahiring sila. Kami sa House, we have to get the permission. We have to have at least 12 members. And since we're on a vacation, so we cannot do more of this kind of hearing. So actually, our first hearing will be on Monday on this one. Pero yung 600 na yan, babagsak din ng 50 yan. It is already defying the laws of gravity. It will fall to 50 pesos. It's natural price. Mm-hmm. And it's actually, right now, you can buy 18 pesos and 85 centavos per kilo of onions from Netherlands, from China, as well as from India. So these three countries actually buy as much as you can. So it's simply because pagpasok dito, may mga mafia who was in control of the ports. So pumunta ka dyan sa Subic, I can tell you at least there are about 50 containers filled with onions who are being delivered little by little so that what essentially they did was predatory pricing. So they came in, brought the prices down, killed the local Filipino farmers, and now they control the supply. Now that they control the supply, they are But I think everything will normalize. There is a reversion to mean. It will go back to 50 pesos. You can cut all my five fingers if it doesn't go back to 50 pesos.
But you really believe 50 pesos when?
Yes. Soon.
Oh.
There's no cartel. I mean, even OPEC, with all its might, they tried to put prices at 130. Now it's back to 60. Ganun naman yan eh. At least for a time, they were able to exploit the situation. And of course, with the connivance of some of our less responsible, I would say, yung mga, I'm talking about customs, I'm talking about the ports, especially in Subic. Mm-hmm. Punta ka na ng Subic, makakita ka ng mga barko dyan, puno ng onion yan.
Mm-hmm. So for you, it's really an cartel. Enforcement issue. Yeah, but it's an enforcement issue in the Philippines, whether it's tax collection, whether it's smuggling.
Unang-una, hindi yan. Kasi dapat, unang-una, bakit 18 lang sa ibang countries? Uh-huh. So it's more than enforcement. It's more about agricultural productivity also.
Okay. Now, is it time for President Marcos Jr. upon his return to already appoint a full-time Agri Secretary?
Masaya. Mas gusto ko nandyan siya eh. Kasi everything that needs to be done most of the time needs signature.
But so, then the DA already recommended an importation last August, and the importation of the president came a bit too late.
Pero bakit 600 pa rin ngayon? So kahit may mga signaling, usually may signaling lang na may papasok na ganun karami, dapat dumadapa na. Ang ibig sabihin, alam ng lahat na hindi rin naman makakapasok yun. Daliipitin na naman sa customs yun. So, yun ang importante dun. So, I think somebody asked me if I were to meet the president, I told him to, I would probably tell him, I want you to be more mean.
What do you mean by that? So you want the president to be more mean?
Mean.
Yeah, I know. Mean. In what way? Or do you mean firmer?
Mabait masyado eh.
CBBM. Masyado mabait. Oo.
In his persona, forget of course the politics and everything. Eh mukhang mas dilawan pa kay Pinoy to eh.
What do you mean by that?
Yung his character, is the way he treats people, the way he is a management style. He is very, actually, hindi naman ultra democratic. He's trying to follow the constitution almost. So he's sobrang mabait actually.
Oo. But in what way na sobrang mabait? You need to give a specific example for you to say that it should be mean. And when you may see mean, do you mean
he
should be firmer, he should be stricter? What is it?
Yeah, stricter. Dapat pag may mga ganyan, tanggal agad.
Oh, yun. Oo. Eh kaso sino tatanggalin niya? Yung undersecretaries? Eh siya yung head ng DA.
Ah, hindi lang naman DM pinag-uusapan dito eh. Baka mapapahamak na ako nito eh ng mga
okay. Ito, pero tulad ng where would you have wanted to see him act on?
Agriculture, of course.
Okay, that's one.
Because that's food security. Definitely. Talaga ang issue yan ng ano ng it's a issue ng estomago. So kailangan talaga unahin mo yan. Kaya pag may mga, sa mga panahon na ganito, ang unahin mo, dapat nutrition. Nutrition, kailangan sa edukasyon. Nutrition, kailangan mo ng healthy workforce. And of course, you need to have national well-being, and that also needs health, and health needs basically good food.
Okay, now you've said earlier that you see the Philippines competing with Vietnam and India as the fastest growing major economy in 2023. I believe the growth forecast for the Philippines by the government is at 6 to 7%, or it's back to 6.5. But the World Bank sees it at 5.4%, and HSBC, I believe, at 4.5%, around those numbers. Where is the 6.5% growth coming from?
Alam mo, una, number one, yung number one export natin is chips. And there's a huge scarcity of chips around the world.
Okay.
And the Philippines is probably best positioned. And I made several comparisons. We have more college graduates. We are more English speaking. We're more trainable. We go back to the same thing. Mm-hmm. So essentially, post-pandemic, the logistical networks, as well as, of course, there's some so many things, but we are probably at one of the highest demand pressure on supply on semiconductors, basically. So that's $50 billion or almost, magkano lang ba ang 80 lang ata ang ano natin. So that's 50 out of the 80 billion of our exports. So I think we have very good prospects there. Second, our OFW, it's very clear to me that there is a resurgence of demand for Filipino labor globally.
It's basically in labor export.
BP, pati
where
BPO.
Our growth is coming from.
BPO, malakas din. Pangalawa, pangapat, we have our independent contractors. These are BPO. These are actually direct hires, bypassing the BPOs. We have about 1.3 million of them who actually cater to mga law firms.
My last question for you is, do you believe the Maharlika Investment Fund will make such a big dent, considering the initial fund for the fund has whittled down, right, without GSIS and SSS? Should the president even have brought it up in Davos?
I don't know whether I should be revealing this, but as is andito na rin lang. Right after Christmas, we were commissioned, me and three others, to essentially re-engineer the Maharlika Investment Fund. Basically, it's now just securitization of the dividend, excluding BSP. No more asset infusion from DBP and
SIF. Bago na to.
So it's very new. So it's basically securitization of about 44.3 billion in annual dividends. So these are real surpluses, including, for example, PDIC at 13 billion, PNOCEC.
All coming from the BSP?
Nothing anymore.
Okay.
Nothing anymore. So basically, these are dividends from GOCC. So by its nature, they are already surpluses. So yung naghahanap na dapat surplus yan, eto, surplus. Hindi namin in-include ang malampaya, but basically, we just started the simpler, the better, and so yung 44.33 billion will be securitized for 20 years. And the amount is, if you securitize 20 years of that using a certain discount rate, it will amount to 765.96 billion pesos.
Okay, model? Where did you get this model, Congressman? From which country?
I came from that industry, ma'am, where you started to know me.
Yeah, yeah. But then it's such a big shift. That's the thing. I'm curious because it's such a big shift from the original.
Oh, yes, ma'am. Because we want this to succeed. And this is the one that was actually sold by the president in Davos. So after that, there will be an IPO.
Really?
The IPO, and there's very strong demand actually, and nakita ni Morgan Stanley is interested. So there's so many other actually big investment banks who are interested in the sovereign development fund. So Upon IPO, it's no longer a GOCC. It will be essentially another listed company in the Philippine stock market. And I think it's up to the president, but the recommendation is that the government will own less than 50%. So it will be private, basically. So,
but with the securitization, is that fund, are you still allowed? Meaning, because it's now going to be listed in the market, the securitization is a certain amount, a programmed earning after 20 years. Can you still use that fund then for the projects that you had wanted in the Philippines?
Ay, opo. Kasi titignan mo naman yung mga, ano ba yung mga malalaki ang return on equity? Halimbawa, dams. Ilang taon na tayo walang dam? 32 years. The last one was in San Roque. Kailangan natin ng tubig para sa inumin, tubig para sa energy, tubig para sa irrigation. So I'm sure na malaki po ang kita doon. So basically, but it's up to the board now.
Yeah.
With the same restrictions that we placed on the Maharlika Fund, since initially we are using the same strictures in the qualifications of the members of the board or the people that the president can nominate to the board to represent the government. So basically, I think it will be more private-led, but definitely it will have public guidance, basically government guidance.
But then this is very different now. So
ayoko.
Did you believe even
kasi
for...
Hindi naman papasa, yung dati kasi hindi naman papasa, kaya yung kinaumagahan na ako tulala.
Natatawa ko sa inyo, Congressman. Yung dati palagay nyo, hindi papasa sa Senado yon.
Hindi naman. Kaya nga tulala ako nung kinausap mo kagad ako. Eh, dahil una-una, hindi, sabi ko, nabigla rin ako sa klase ng ano na... But now I think this is well thought out, and then basically I don't know whether I am free to because we were four who worked on it right after Christmas. We were commissioned basically, and we submitted it, and apparently the president has a go on it. So basically it's just I think a matter of details. He may pick to, for example, follow the Indonesian model. So yung Indonesian model, ang pinasok lang, 4.8 billion, tsaka yung pinasok lang niya, actually, $1 billion na infusion of cash. At karamihan, ang kanyang inano is share for asset arrangement. And the country has at least, you know, a minimum of 3 trillion in assets that if he wishes to inject into it. I mean, it's up to us, but I think the simpler, the better. So,
because the Indonesian fund accepts foreign investors as well.
Oh, so, tama, pares kami.
Are we gonna do that too?
Opo.
Okay.
Definitely. Yeah. Definitely. Kaya nga, the government will have not a minority position. It will have less than 50% of the so-called Maharlika Investment Fund. Definitely, it is an IPO. It is a securitization of the dividends, excluding BSP and all the other highly controversial sources of funds. And essentially, it will add value to the extent that by doing an IPO. So, ang IPO kasi, easily, you can, depending on the PE that you will want to use, it can easily raise 1.2 trillion. If you ask me. So you would have a fund that has 1.2 trillion with the commitment from the government that 20 years of dividends are securitized inside as part of the initial capitalization of this Maharlika Investment Fund. I'm not going beyond my... I did not sign any non-disclosure agreement, so I don't know.
Because you've shared it already on Head Start. But no, I do hope to see a copy of that, because that's entirely different from the one that was discussed.
Oh, nga. Kaya tuwan-tuwa ako. Tira ng tira yung mga tao. They are, you know, they're addressing a very different anima altogether already. So,
all right. Yeah.
But it seems in Davos, investors are very positive about it because they
because
are.
Because he's reading off the new model that month. Yes. Amendment. Right. Yes. All right. Congressman Joey Salceda, I want to thank you for joining me as always. It's always a pleasure speaking with you, sir. You have a good day and a blessed new year to you.
Thank you very much, Karen. And I hope you still have 10 minutes actually for the rest of your news.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you, Congressman. Thank you.